In this movie, we'll look at a couple of vowel charts and see how vowels might be represented slightly differently by different phoneticians. While you will find some minor differences in these representations, keep in mind that in the big picture view, things are really pretty consistent. So this is the vowel quadrilateral that I want you to learn for this course. The exact location of most vowels is not as important as the relative locations. For example, E should always be higher up and further to the front than the I. But if the I were a little bit moved away from this location, it'd be okay, as long as it's lower and more central than E, and higher and more central than A, then it's fine. One principle that's often used is to make vowels more or less equidistant from each other. So where we have the sequence E, I, A, E, A in the front space, some charts try to make sure that all of these vowels are distributed roughly equally across the high to low space. You can see that I have more distance between E and A than I do between the other vowels in the front space. Perhaps this is imperfect, but it's okay. And when you come to draw your own vowel chart, which you will have to do as a part of this course, by the way, you don't have to have more distance between E and A just because my chart here happens to have that extra distance. As an example of the variety that exists in vowel charts, I wanted to show you this one, which you'll note has a lot of distance between E and I, and not very much distance at all between I and A. In fact, it also represents A as a monophthong. You'll also note that this chart has 5 levels of height represented in order to give the lax vowels I, E, A, and U their own height designation. The chart itself is doing the same thing as the tense lax distinction is doing on our chart, providing a systematic way to distinguish vowels that share a quadrant on the chart. They are doing it with height, and we'll do it with a tense lax distinction. You'll also see that on this chart, the caret vowel is in the low area. Many vowel charts want the caret vowel to be lower or more back than schwa. It's not technically wrong to do it this way, but for our course, it'll be simpler to treat caret and schwa as both being mid-central vowels, as both sounding like and as being differentiated only by stress, not by which quadrant they're in on the chart. Finally, you'll see a few symbols on this chart that we haven't discussed yet. The symbol that looks like a 3 is a vowel that's used in British English, but not in American English. We won't worry about that for now. The other two symbols have this little hook at the end of them. We'll introduce these vowels in a later movie. It's good to remember them as mid-central vowels, but you won't have to place them on a vowel quadrilateral during this course. I put a chart like this up to show that there are several different ways of representing the vowel space, and the most important thing is the relative position of the vowels compared to their neighboring vowels, and the understanding of how the terms high, mid, and low, along with front, central, and back, relate to these vowel symbols.